Hey everyone, welcome back to another video. In this video, we're going to be looking at a chess game between Grandmaster Vishwanathan Anand and Indian cricket player Yuzvendra Chahal. Now, I'm a huge fan of both cricket and chess. I've been playing chess most of my life, and I've also been following cricket for most of my life. And so, this game is pretty special to me because it's one of my favorite chess players of all time playing against one of my favorite cricketers of all time. So, I've looked up to Anand since I was little, and I've also had the privilege of, you know, watching Chahal's career grow. He spent the last 7 years at my favorite cricket franchisee, the Royal Challengers, and I've seen him sort of transition into the Indian cricket team in the last 4 years. It's been quite nice to see. So, this is a pretty special game. So, this was played at a charity event recently hosted by chess.com and Samai Raina, I believe, to help raise some funds for the COVID-19 effort in India. So, Anand was actually playing a simultaneous exhibition. He was playing several different games at the same time. This was one of them, and so without further ado, let's dive right into this game. All right, so Anand with the white pieces, he opens up with e4. Yuzi continues with c5, just getting the Sicilian defense on the board here. And Anand continues with c3, the Alapin variation, which is a known way to counter the Sicilian. It's a good way to counter the Sicilian, and also in particular it gives you a really nice control of this d4 square, which in this particular game will actually be important. So Yuzi continues with e5. So this is not necessarily a terrible move, but what it does do is it denies Yuzi the opportunity to play e6 later on in the game if he needs to. Because very often in the Sicilian you'll see e6 played as a response to bishop to c4, because early on sometimes this bishop c4 has some nasty threats here, so you like to see e6 in the Sicilian very often just to keep that at bay. So he can't play that anymore, just something to keep in mind. Anand continues knight to f3, it's getting his knight into the game. Knight c6, standard development, then you have bishop c4, knight f6, and now Anand comes in with d3. So he not only defends this pawn, which the knight on knight can't really come to c3 to do, and he also opens up the line for this nice bishop here, this dark squared bishop, to come out and deliver some attacks on this long diagonal. Bishop e7 comes in, perhaps in bearing in mind that Anand has this bishop to g5 move, which would pin the knight. So this bishop e7 is just preemptively saying that it's not going to work, because then you can just move this knight any. Because if bishop g5, well, you can just move the knight away, and there's no pin, right? Well, Anand plays bishop g5 anyways, yeah, and Yuzi continues with a6, this idea being, of course, you can come in with b5 and start to push this bishop back, and if bishop goes to b3, if c4, so you can start to break open the center a little bit there. So that's the idea. Anand takes here this bishop, this knight on f6, he just trades that down. You have bishop takes bishop, and now Anand plays a4, so now he's just sort of saying, if you play b5, I can just take it away. I can just take it, and it also gives you this option to bring your bishop back to a2 if needed. But one thing that this trade also does is it means that Yuzi can no longer play d5 if he needed to. Because when the knight's still there, you could potentially play d5 and deflect this bishop off this diagonal if you needed to. Or at least keep it off immediately. But now, this move d5 is only defended by the queen, so you can't really... it's no longer viable because you have two attackers. Oops. So in this position, Yuzi goes in and plays d6, right? Just getting this bishop the chance to come into the game and just solidifying this pawn structure here. Anand goes in with knight a3. He comes in knight a3 just saying, all right, let's get this knight into the action. It's currently pretty passive over there. Yuzi goes ahead and castles, just gets his king to safety, and knight to c2. So just getting this knight into a slightly better position than it was on a3, because now it defends the d4 square. Can also come up to e3 here and sort of start to, get some play in the center. You have bishop g4 by Yuzi. Again, the bishop g4 move is not a terrible move at all by any means, but the only trouble here is there's just not a lot of things you can do to follow it up. Because when you play a move like bishop g4, you generally like to have some sort of a follow-up threat. So, for example, something like knight to e5, or if you have the option, something like e4. These are good moves because they also pile up on this pinned knight here and give you some really fun options there. Yuzi doesn't really have anything like that here, right? Because knight to d4 is met by this c3 pawn. Again, really nice c3 pawn there. It really keeps this knight at bay for the entire game here. And there's just no other threats you can bring in immediately. So it didn't seem super necessary to me, but nonetheless, it's not a terrible move. Then you have knight e3, again, just doing as we just talked about, getting this knight into the center. You have this, we have a lot, this knight has a lot more range here in the center. Provides some defense with the c4 bishop, also, you know, gives you some play with these squares, and also develops with tempo by attacking this bishop here. So using actually here, he makes a little bit of a mistake that sort of tanks the game for him, and he plays bishop to g5. So this is a blunder, because as you can see here, this bishop on g4 is just hanging, right? So he just loses the bishop for free, and so now he has no compensation for that. So now he has to find a way to fight this back. He goes with king to h8. So the idea here is this pawn initially, while the king was on g8, this pawn was pinned to the king by this nice light square bishop here. But now by moving his king to h8, he's sort of giving himself the option to come in potentially with f5 later on, get his rook into the game, and you know, just sort of try to push into the center from this side of things. Anand comes in with h4, driving this bishop back. So the bishop goes back to h6. And Anand is happy to trade down here, so he just takes this, we have a trade here. And again, Anand's a piece up, so he's happy to take the trades as they come. So, and now you have g4. Again, really just pushing at the black king here, because you can already see the black king, the king side's a little fragmented, so Anand's just really trying to push hard at it here with g4. You have f6, preventing this g5 thrust here. And now you have queen d2, so just keep putting an attacker on this h6 square, which is really a big vulnerability for black there. He has no good way to defend this, so usually he comes in with king to h8. It's probably the best way to go ahead and defend that. There's not a lot of other great options. So now you have bishop e6. So getting your bishop into this nice square here, preparing for bishop f5, which is a really strong outpost because it's supported by these two pawns, and you know, black doesn't have a lot of good ways to kick back that bishop. So queen e7, again trying to get that bishop out of there. You have bishop f5, just like we talked about, a very strong outpost for that bishop there. And now usually comes in with rook g8, just hoping to sort of get some play with this rook, get it to on this nice open file here, the semi-open file here, just to get some counterplay. Anand now comes in with g5, and usually plays h5. So again, the idea here is he just doesn't want to give Anand the option to go after that h7 pawn if he captures. Because if you take here, and you take here, then this falls, and you have, not only is this rook very well positioned, the bishop defends it, you now have a skewer and you lose your queen. So you can't do that. So Yuzi just says, you know, let's keep this close. And he's inviting him to come and capture here on f6, because then that gives him a nice open file here with his rook. So Anand accepts, goes here, grabs this, queen takes here. And now you have queen g5 check. So now you're forcing a trade of queens here. So Yuzi has to accept this. You have a trade here. And this is good for Anand again, because again, he's just compounding on that advantage that he gained from that free bishop there. So he's now just really sort of just pushing that material gain by just trading off pieces. And now you have h6. Just nice, just sort of, you know, trying to push this pawn off, try to get his rook in, get his rook this nice open file. Anand comes in with rook takes on h5, and that's a good move, because if you take this right away and you take with the king, this pawn is for now at least somewhat secure. But now by taking on h5, this pawn is now under a lot of pressure, and you also have this other option coming, of course, of rook to h7 check, because it's defended by the bishop here. That gives you some really nice options. You can go after that b7 pawn there, and a rook on the 7th rank is just always very, very powerful. So Yuzi goes ahead and takes this, and now Anand actually doesn't go for that. He goes for king to h2. Okay, king to e2, excuse me. So now he's saying, I can now bring this rook into the game as well, right? And that gives him an even stronger attack, because this g5 pawn is very difficult to defend at this point. The king can't really come in. King could probably come to f6, but that's probably the extent of it. But you already have two different attackers on this pawn already. So rook to g1 now is a very strong move that's coming up. So Yuzi here goes with g4. So now at least you kind of, you know, you're moving it with a little bit of tempo. So he has to capture this right away. And you have a little bit of time to sort of get your king to a slightly better spot here. So king f6, now just doing just that, just getting his king to a slightly better square here. Also opening this rook here to eye down on this bishop here on g4. So Anand remedies that, bishop to f5. Again, putting this bishop on a very strong square that's defended here, and also is going to block the king in. So, and Yuzi here plays rook to g7, trying to maybe double up the rooks, look for some sort of a counterplay there, and also blocking this rook to h7 here, which would otherwise go for that this b7 pawn. But Anand comes in with rook to h6 check now, right? And Yuzi goes with king to f7, and now Anand grabs this d6 pawn, and it's in this position that Yuzi resigned the game. So, because there's not a lot of great play you have here, because once again, this knight here is actually, even though it's, you know, he technically has that piece, it just doesn't do much, right? Because you can't really move it to any of these really nice squares here because of the c3 pawn. And so you just have to move it back, and it's just not a great knight. On the other hand, Anand has this really powerful rook here. His bishop is in a really strong square. It's going to be very difficult for Yuzi to dislodge that. This knight can always come into the game with, you know, maybe knight to e5 coming in the future. And of course, this rook to g1 is also really a dangerous threat. But he also has potential of rook to d7 check if he wants, trade off this rook, and also put an attack on that b7 pawn. So a lot of different options coming in for Vishy Anand, and just there's just not a lot you can do here. So pretty nice game, I thought. Real props to Yuzi Chahal, because he actually used to represent India in chess in many years ago. He played under 12 for India, but since then he hasn't played a lot of chess. So it's very impressive of him to hold up against a former world champion like this, and especially someone as good as Vishy Anand, to hold up against him for this long and not make that many blunders is quite impressive. So we played a really good game here. Besides that bishop to g5 move there, that when he lost the bishop, he gave up the free bishop. Everything else he did pretty well. You know, against Anand, there's just not much you can do, especially in that position. He held his own pretty well. So a really fun game here. And I hope you like this analysis. Don't worry, I will have more AP Calc, more Calc content coming in the near future. Just have to write up some lesson plans. I haven't had time to do that lately, but we'll have more of that coming very, very soon. If you like this analysis, do let me know. I would love to make more if that's something you guys like. And it was just good feedback for me because I haven't made a chess video in like 7 years. Hope this was helpful, and I'll see you again later. Take care.